tonight, as I mentioned, worked with Senator Portman and Senator Peters to hold hearings and issue a bipartisan report with the Homeland Security Committee with recommendations that could be implemented without delay. This is our sixth hearing on Capitol security during this Congress. Significant progress has been made to implement our recommendations for the entities charged with protecting the Capitol. The majority have been put into effect entirely, as well as more than 75% of the Capitol Police Inspector General's 103 recommendations. Through these efforts, the department has improved its handling of intelligence by hiring a new intelligence director and sharing information with rank and file officers, prioritized operational planning by requiring plans for large-scale events, and used the resources in last year's emergency appropriations legislation to ensure officers have the training and the equipment that they need. We will never forget the stories of the riot gear left in the buses locked. We'll never forget the stories of what a high percentage, and of course you were not chief then, but what a high percentage of our officers were not equipped with riot gear, and in fact the people attacking them in some cases had gear that they didn't even have on themselves. The department also faced the difficult task of confronting a shortfall in officers since January 6, which placed even more pressure on those protecting our Capitol. I appreciate your work, Chief, to take this on head on, to restore morale and confidence in your ranks. I still remember when I knew that the morale was improving about 6 months after the attack. I remember how difficult it was in those weeks and months afterwards. But about 6 months after the attack, I was outside in the parking area, and I was standing there, and one of the officers was talking to me, and one of your other officers was on bike patrol, and he put up his megaphone, and he said, "Officer," use the name of the guy I was talking to, "do you need backup? Do you need backup?" And I thought at that moment, whatever is going on, there has been some improvement in morale that people can once again have a little moment of fun and appreciate the surroundings that they're in. As I've told your officers, including last week, they are the ones that are on the front line every single day for our safety and also the front line of what visitors to the Capitol see. Your efforts have paid off, Chief, as the department met its goal to hire 280 officers this year and is on track to do the same next year. Your work to recruit more officers and overcome attrition has been integral to reopening the Capitol. We have had tour groups back for nearly 9 months now, and the Capitol Visitor Center reopened about 7 months ago. Just last week, another entrance to the Senate office buildings opened, and we'll open at least one more in January when the public galleries are planned to be open as well. We know it has been long, long in coming, but we understand your plan to ensure us safety and slowly and surely open up some of these areas, because we could not do it all at once, and we still can't do every single thing we were doing before. So there has been significant progress, but there's also much more to do. And I know you know that in one of those goals is to confront the dramatic rise in threats targeting members of Congress. While the department has hired more threat assessment agents and opened two field offices to counter these threats, more must be done. Chief, I know you have presented a proposal to the Capitol Police Board laying out resources that the department needs to be effective given the current threat landscape to ensure members are safe when they are away from the Capitol. One of the things we also talked about in that last meeting that Senator Blunt and I attended was about the prosecution of these cases, which is not under your purview. One thing that's not, but making sure that they occur. And I've already contacted the Justice Department about that. Another thing we should do without delay is to pass my bipartisan proposal with Senator Cruz to provide for the removal of members of Congress's private information from the internet, similar to a provision for federal judges that was just included in the NDAA. And I continue to work to get this done by the end of the year. I look forward to hearing from you today, Chief. Now, before I turn it over to Senator Blunt, I wanted to talk a little bit about his work and recognize the importance of his service, not just to this committee, but really to our Capitol and to our country. Through our work leading the Rules Committee, sometimes he's been chair, Sometimes I've been chair. Sometimes it just doesn't matter who's chair because we work together so well. I've gotten to see firsthand Chairman Blunt's, former chairman, now ranking member Blunt's, deep respect for our Constitution, for the Senate, and our democracy. As a former top election official in Missouri, Senator Blunt's experience benefited our committee as we worked to support the work of election administrators, including highlighting the rise in threats in the hearing we did last year. And since coming to the Senate, Senator Blunt's love for this institution has come through in his efforts to make this a better place to work. That includes not okaying every request we get from every member, but whenever we can, we try to do that. It includes joining with me to reform the outdated process of reporting and handling sexual harassment claims on Capitol Hill. Many great improvements were made that have been helpful for this institution. It includes updating the rules for new parents when we work to ensure that Senator Duckworth and future parents can bring their babies to the Senate floor. He's also been a great partner to me on many other issues, including we co-chaired the Travel and Tourism Caucus and passed Brand USA several times. He co-chaired the Adoption Caucus with me. We got a number of bills passed over the year. He himself, the parent of adopted child Charlie Blunt, that he loves so much, and he has taken that heart and put it into that issue as well. Above all else, Senator Blunt's career here has been defined by service. He is more interested in getting things done than getting the accolades. Although I know, talking to your wife, Abby, there have been a lot of accolades in recent months. Buildings named after you, airports named after you, all well deserved. But what I will most remember about Senator Blunt is that moment on January 6th when it was just the two of us and Vice President Pence walking through that corridor that in the morning had been a place of celebration, walking through the broken glass, the spray-painted columns to do our jobs. And when we came back at, then it was about 4:30 in the morning when it was all done and democracy had prevailed, he and I decided to go downstairs to look at the damage to the parliamentarian office and other offices. And it was a horrendous sight, pictures broken, their own personal belongings all over the floor. And we knew then that our work hadn't ended really that day, but our work had just begun to protect the security of the Capitol. But I most remember in a typical Roy Blunt way, as we walk out of that office and the sun is coming out, he turns to me in all seriousness and says, "Well, see you tomorrow." And I said, "Tomorrow's here, exactly. But I will." And I think that's what we say to Senator Blunt today, that we will see you tomorrow and we will see you many days to come. And we are also excited that Senator Fisher will actually become the ranking member. She and I get along very well. She had asked me to be her Democratic mentor, whatever that meant, when she came to the Senate. I tried my best. And we're really excited that she's going to be filling in here and becoming the ranking member. But Roy, we are all going to miss you. I know Angus came in specifically to recognize your work, and we thank you, Roy, for all you've done. So we should give you applause here.
Thank all of you. As Abby Blunt would quickly point out, there have been plenty of recognitions for me, and she's doing her job to be sure that I keep that in some balance by representing the other side of the question of how capable I may or may not be. But glad to be here with all of you. This is a unique committee, and the opportunity to be so involved all the time, and sometimes almost too involved some days, which is the daily operation of the Senate. It gives those of us who've done management things, like the governor and others, a chance to have a little bit of that management desire fulfilled, a chance to really work directly with the chief and the Librarian of Congress and the director of the Smithsonian and, unfortunately, the food service companies and the things that are really been complicated the last few years as the visits to the Capitol were dramatically changed when the Capitol building itself wasn't open. But I appreciate your kind words. And, you know, we have served on this committee together, both in 2017 and then dramatically in 2021. We were two of the four people that joined first Vice President Biden in 2017 and then Vice President Pence in 2021 to go through the process of certifying the election. And then only a few days later, 2 weeks in effect later, in 2021 at the exact same location where a great Capitol Police Force and the Metropolitan Police Force had been trying to defend the Capitol and did defend the Capitol. We're out there where we should be for the whole world to watch the peaceful transition of power. And from that day, I was the chairman of that event, and the chairman has some gavels to use that day as necessary. Here's one for you, and the base says the 59th presidential inauguration, January 20th, 2021.
Thank you.
And as you pointed out, we've worked on so many things, it's almost made the work of this committee seamless. We go from two or three different issues we're working on, from adoption to travel to visa to commerce, all at once. And we've been great friends, and I look forward to that continued friendship with you and others on the Rules Committee. Been chairman twice, let's see. I was chairman, then Senator Shelby was chairman, and then I was chairman again, and it's been great to work with you in this divided Congress as you become chairman. I know I'm leaving the committee in good hands as Senator Fisher moves into the position of ranking member at the beginning of the next Congress. She's been a member of the Rules Committee since she came to Congress after the 2012 election, and I feel confident that the two of you are going to do great things for the Senate and the people who work here. One of the most important functions, of course, is our relationship with the police, the Capitol Police, who every member of Congress sees multiple times every day from the moment we walk in. As a matter of fact, usually before we walk in until the moment we walk out of the building and then the moment we're headed away from the Capitol. Chief Manger was hired in the wake of the events of January the 6th. He brought incredible experience to this job, having been the chief of two of the very biggest neighboring jurisdictions. I'm eager to hear his assessment of where we are on the recommendations we made. And you know that coming quickly with our committee and the other oversight committee and having those hearings, having a set of recommendations within just a couple of months, really, of the time that we started looking at this. And I know one of the things we'll talk to the chief today about that. Also, later this afternoon, you and I'll both be at a event where the 2021 Freedom Award is awarded. The 2022 Freedom Award recipients will be awarded, and that's the Capitol Police and the Metropolitan Police. Chief Manger and Chief Conte will be there to recognize and accept that recognition. I think that award was started in 20 years ago in 1993. That was the 200th anniversary of George Washington laying the cornerstone for the Capitol that would be begun here and was finished a few years later in Washington. But the Freedom Award, named for the statue on the top of the Capitol, the Statue of Freedom. And Chief, your officers and the Metropolitan Police officers who arrived immediately when called made an incredible difference that day, as they do every day. And Senator Klobuchar and I and the rest of the members of the committee are honored to be able to welcome you here today, and thank you, Chairman.
Very good. Senator Fisher, you want to add something? And thank you, Senator Wicker, for being here as well.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I want to thank Senator Blunt for his time as chair and ranking member of this committee. As the former top election official in Missouri, his firsthand knowledge of the elections process was incredibly valuable to this committee. Senator Blunt understands every policy issue that comes before him with a curious mind and tireless attention to detail. He has always been a trusted voice in our conference and an exceptional member of leadership. As Leader McConnell said earlier this month, Senator Blunt has time and again wound up in the middle of high-stakes, high-profile work. Yet he remains the same humble and approachable Missourian who first got into this business to help his neighbors. I want to thank Roy for his work to ensure a smooth transition to me as the new ranking member on this committee. He's been very helpful in this process, ensuring that both the Republican Rules Committee staff and my personal staff have the information they need and that we are all in a position to succeed. In the video announcing his retirement, Senator Blunt stood on the dairy farm where he grew up and said that he planned to finish strong, and he certainly has. After 14 general election victories and 26 years in Congress, Senator Blunt has a lot to be proud of. I know we're certainly going to miss him here in the Senate. Missourians, Nebraskans, and all Americans are better off thanks to his selfless service. Thank you.
Thank
you. Good job, Roy.
Really nice. And thank you for mentioning Senator Blunt's tremendous staff. That's really worked seamlessly, as you noted. Senator Wicker, you want to add anything? And then maybe Senator King.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. And I spoke from my heart on the Senate floor several days ago after Senator Blunt's farewell address. Let me just echo what Senator Fisher has said and say how fortunate I feel to have served with Roy Blunt, both on this committee, on the Commerce Committee, in the House, and in the U.S. Senate. I got to the House 2 years before he did. I got over here to the Senate a little bit before he did. But I was well aware that once he got here, he would immediately move into leadership. And I was tickled to be a part of that small cadre of people that encouraged Senator Blunt to run for leadership at a very early point in his Senate career. Senator Fisher mentioned high stakes and high profile moments in quoting our distinguished Republican leader. It does seem that when fortune smiles on us, whether by chance or by providence, the right person happens to be at the right place, in the right position, at the right time. And I think of January 20th, 2017, when we showed the world once again what President Reagan said was a both profound and commonplace moment. Commonplace because it occurs every 4 years. Profound because it occurs every 4 years on the dot. And the way our friend from Missouri was asked to be in charge of that orderly constitutional transfer of power. And then it happened that our friend Roy was called on to be the symbol of that orderly constitutional transfer after a time when the decision was much more contentious. And I cannot think of another fellow citizen of the United States who would have been better capable of carrying that off and making that day once again profound and commonplace. And so I thank the chair for reminding me earlier today that
you mean sending him a text.
This was a special command performance to me, and I'm grateful to her for reminding me. Also, I'm grateful to both of you for allowing me to remodel my committee room before any others. Mm-hmm. And we would not have done it without the leadership of these two great friends on the committee. So, Roy, congratulations to you. Surely this is the last time I'll have to wax sentimental, but it's been a great run, and you have been a great public servant and will always be my great friend.
All right, and thank you, Senator Wicker, for bringing up the inauguration, which I hadn't. That was an incredible moment. You mentioned both inaugurations where Roy just really stood out for his work, so thank you. Senator King.
Very briefly, because everything's been said. Roy was one of the first people I met when I got here. Just a few weeks, I don't even think I'd been sworn in yet. We had a chat, and we found that we were both adoptive parents. And we shared the fact that any adoptive parent will tell you that you fall in love with those kids just like any other kids. And how important that, and both, in fact, adoptive parents of children from abroad, and the important thing about making them part of our family. Unfortunately, we haven't had a chance to really work together very much on legislation, but my observation of Roy, a couple of points. One is the example of leadership is so important. We tend to think of leadership as speeches and pushing and amendments and arguing and debating. Just the example that you set of a dignity, common sense, thoughtfulness has been an example to me. And I think it's one that's so important to your colleagues. That's one of the reasons you're going to be so missed. One of the definitions of courage is grace under pressure. And I think on January 6th, and again on January 21st, it wasn't a foregone conclusion how things were going to go that day. It was your grace under pressure, your steadiness, that I think meant so much to all of us, but mostly to the country. Mostly to the country. And I love Ronald Reagan's comment that it's commonplace and profound. Profound because it's commonplace, because what we have here is very unusual in human history. And it's fragile, as we learned. And your steadiness and good common sense, good Midwestern common sense. I'm married to a girl from the Midwest, and she reminds me of that. A woman from the Midwest.
That's okay.
We've been married almost 40 years. And anyway, Roy, you've meant so much to all of us, but you've meant so much to the country. Thank you deeply for your service.
Very good. Very nice. And I actually have a picture of us, Roy, that I like because it looked out, you know, it looks like you have a baby thinking, what is she saying? Anyway, it's great. So there you are. So I'm now my job.
Chief, I guess you thought this hearing was about you.
is to introduce Chief Manger, the Chief of the United States Capitol Police. He was sworn into his current position on July 23rd, 2021, after a distinguished 42-year career in law enforcement, longer than Angus has been married, most recently serving for 15 years as Chief of Police in Montgomery County, Maryland. Earlier in his career, he served as Chief of Police in Fairfax County, Virginia, where he rose through the ranks after first joining the force following his graduation from the University of Maryland. I'll now swear in the witness. If you would please stand and raise your right hand, you swear that the testimony you will give before the committee shall be the truth, all truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
Thank you, Chief. You can be seated, and you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Chairwoman Klobuchar, Ranking Member Blunt, distinguished members of the committee, thank you for this opportunity to share with you the many initiatives currently underway to strengthen the U.S. Capitol Police Department. Having been in this position for nearly a year and a half, we now move from fixing the immediate problems identified on January 6th and its aftermath to better positioning the department for the future. The USCP mission is highly complex. To fulfill our responsibilities, we need to flexibility to pivot seamlessly from our public order responsibilities to our investigative responsibilities to our protection responsibilities. My first priority when I arrived here was fixing the systemic deficiencies that lay at the root of its operational and intelligence capabilities. The department identified, prioritized, and remediated the most significant gaps, including those identified by this committee, such as developing department-wide operational plans for special events, training and equipping the civil disturbance unit, and improving the department's intelligence gathering and sharing capabilities. These front burner priorities have largely been remediated. In fact, of the 103 Inspector General recommendations that came out in the flash reports, 70 of them have been closed, with most others on a glide path to closure. While certain items remain on the department's post-January 6th to-do list, we are working on three key areas: threat investigations, fully reopening the Capitol, and staffing. Among the most significant challenges that we're facing is the ever-changing threat landscape. Hate, intolerance, and violence are part of a disturbing trend. This past year, the department saw more than 9,000 threats against members of Congress. The attacks on Representative Lee Zeldin and Paul Pelosi, as well as the threats directed toward other members of Congress, are a sad reminder of the extent to which our social fabric has frayed. Not surprisingly, then, the bulk of the department's current efforts are directed to threat assessment and mitigation. These efforts include an increase in the number of dignitary protection agents, as well as the training of a reserve team to supplement protection advance teams. Enhanced security protections for members, their families, and their homes. To that end, the department has presented a list of security recommendations and options to the Capitol Police Board and the relevant appropriations committees of both chambers. These recommendations span the gamut of enhanced security protections and include the installation of state-of-the-art residential security systems for every member of Congress, the creation of a protection operations center, and the expansion of memorandums of understanding with local law enforcement agencies nationwide. With the increase of USCP staffing over the past year, I'm confident that we're on track to meet our goal of fully reopening the Capitol. However, to meet our ever-growing workload demands, our goal is to increase the sworn police staffing to more than 2,000 officers and our civilian staff to over 450 by the end of fiscal year 2023. Since January 6th, we have hired over 350 new recruits, 175 of which have graduated from the academy and are now covering posts throughout the Capitol grounds. Our hiring and recruitment efforts also include 55 contract Capitol security officers, a launch of lateral hiring program, and the payment of retention bonuses. These enhancements should enable the department to meet its target of fully reopening the Capitol to pre-COVID levels within the next 3 months. As part of the department's continuous transformation, we're working on a department-wide reorganization plan. Not only is this in response to the recommendations and findings of various after-action reports, it is also necessary to establish a structure that fosters and reinforces accountability, internal controls, and employee development. We've submitted our proposal to the board, which is currently under review. Once approved, it will allow a number of senior leadership positions to be filled. Our ability to enhance the protection of members and their families is part of a holistic law enforcement and investigative process. It's not enough just to identify the bad actors. Those that commit prosecutable offenses must be called to account for their actions within the criminal justice system. Recognizing that these threats are difficult to prosecute, it is disheartening to me that our prosecution rate remains so low. We have made significant inroads on that front by establishing three special U.S. attorney positions assigned to the Capitol Police for the express purpose of prosecuting those threat cases. Let me conclude by stating that our increasing workload, the current threat landscape, and future challenges, both known and unknown, will require additional resources. This is a reality, and I say this fully acknowledging all the support that we have received so far. But if we're to build, enhance, and protect to the scale of the entire Congress, we cannot do it based on our current resources. Simply stated, if we are to keep pace with the workload demands as well as the member expectations, the focus should be on where we are today and the department's vision for the future. I'm steadfast and resolute in ensuring that an incident like January 6th never happens again. All of our projects and initiatives require the support of the board and our oversight committees. Your committee has provided constructive input and oversight. At the same time, it has been a staunch supporter of the department, and I thank you.
Thank you very much, Chief. For his last hearing, we're going to have Senator Blunt go first, then I'll ask questions, and then Senator King, and then whatever Republican is next. So thank you.
All right. Thank you, Chair. Chief, on the recommendations that we made after January the 6th, I think you've completed about 75% of those. It's also my impression that you may need more funding or more authority or both to really address the remaining numbers. Is that correct?
The authority, not as much. That was provided, and that has been working fine. In terms of the funding, what we've done in the past year or so has addressed the security here at the Capitol. And then what we really have to focus on now are the threats against members. And that's not only addressing the threats while you are here in the Capitol, but when you're in your home districts as well. Those protection responsibilities will require additional resources, and we've got in our FY23 budget, for instance, there are a number of requests for additional positions that address the protection responsibilities that where we really need to focus.
So currently you have vacancies of about, 10% still vacant? Tell me, how many officers do you have right
now? So we have right now about 1,970 officers.
And you're authorized to have?
We're authorized to have over 2,000, or close to 2,100. And so, yeah, we're about, I think, 10%. But I have to share with you that I just was informed today that as we speak, we have 219 recruits in some level of training, we just brought them on a week ago to the ones that are just about to graduate. So we've got 219 recruits in the pipeline, so which I think sets us up very well, and we will continue to work on our hiring and recruiting and hiring initiatives so that we keep that pipeline full so that we can meet our goal of hiring those 280 officers per year for the next couple of years.
And how many officers have you brought in the year and a half that you've been the chief?
Close to 200. So when you couple that with the attrition, we are in fact the last time that I was in front of this committee, we have now 100 more officers than we had then.
And how's the addition of the contract employees go for the jobs you've been able to assign to someone who wasn't a sworn and totally prepared officer?
So that's I think has gone very well. The key there is to identify the posts that it would be suitable to have a contract security or capital security officer. And these are primarily secondary posts, and we've got about 50 or so assigned. And right now we're looking for other opportunities. If there are other posts where we can use those capital security officers, we will. But right now, we've got about 50 of them in place. And so that's 50 posts where we used to have Capitol police officers that are now freed up with these security officers staffing those locations.
As you move to more security for members at their state, what kind of additional personnel will you need there?
So part of the options that I've presented to the Capitol Police Board is to do for the entire Congress what the House has begun to do for their members, where every member of Congress would have a security system in their home, in their district offices, so that it would add a layer of protection for not only the member, but their family and their staff as well. One of the things that I would recommended is to have to stand up a protection operations center so that we would have our folks whether, and this could be done by civilians, wouldn't have to be sworn officers, but have our folks monitor those security systems. They would also be monitored by the company that installed them, but to have that redundancy and to have that instant recognition if there's a problem and the instant response if there's a problem, I think provides exactly what we need in terms of enhancing the protection. So we want to stand up the Protection Operations Center. The big ask is really has to do with the number of protection agents for the members. Right now, we don't provide the level of protection to some of the leadership that perhaps we should. It's certainly not on par with what is done in the executive branch. And I think we need to look at that and strengthen some of the protection details that we have in place. But as a result of the number of threats that are coming in and the number of credible threats that we have some concern about, I believe that we need to strongly expand the number of protection agents that we have. And again, I've got, I think in the FY23 budget, there were 64 positions, additional special agent positions that would be assigned to protection details. And with the demands that we have, this is both in terms of protection and investigation of threats, I think this is the big ask that we have.
Thank you. I may have more questions later, Chairman, but.
Very good. Senator King has an important call coming up, so I'm going to have him go next.
Thank you, Senator. Chief, just to give you an idea of how far the Capitol Police have come, I had a friend who was a Capitol policeman in the 60s, and he told me that the firearms competency test consisted of handing the recruit a gun and having them shoot at the target until they hit it, and then they were successfully passed the test. Fortunately, I think we've gone beyond those days. I want to compliment you on your recruiting. And I think the challenge of protection at home is a huge, serious challenge. If we had, as governor, I had a trooper with me 24 hours a day for 8 years. If we went to that level for every member of Congress, it would be hugely expensive and in many ways obtrusive. It seems to me that one fruitful area that you might think about pursuing, and you may already be doing this, is a cooperative relationship with local police departments and state police, who the members aren't home all the time, but they can be there, at least be on call, and perhaps even go further in terms of being present for public events and those kinds of things. Is that something that might be a way to solve this without hiring another 435 times five?
Absolutely, and we have one of the other things that I forgot to mention, Senator, was getting together a small staff that would work full time in developing those relationships with the state and local law enforcement for every member of Congress. If we, there's 538 jurisdictions that would be involved, and we would have get those MOUs in place so that we wouldn't have to wait for a crisis to make the first call to that local agency saying, "Hey, can you help us out?" We would have those MOUs in place ahead of time, so it would be a very efficient process to get the help we need. Your suggestion about having local law enforcement at events where there may be issues where the public will be there and perhaps the member even has a couple of threats that they're concerned about. Having local law enforcement there is something that we want to do routinely. And the advantage that we have now is that as a result of the supplemental from last year, we have funding that we can reimburse these jurisdictions. So many of these jurisdictions, have told us, look, we have staffing shortages, we don't really have the folks to do some of the things you're asking us to do, but when we say we can reimburse you and we can, if you need to pull somebody in on overtime, right, we can reimburse that for you, it really enhances their ability
and
to help us.
And even that reimbursement would be far less expensive than having five full-time agents. You mentioned the number of threats, and I'm not sure whether you have the historical data, but my sense is this is going up significantly. Is that accurate?
Absolutely is accurate. I can tell you that back in 2017, we had 1,000, maybe, somewhere around 1,000, and last year 9,000. And it has gone up steadily and profoundly over the last 5 or 6 years.
That's very disturbing. One other area of questioning, and Senator Blunt touched on this. It seems like you're doing fairly well recruiting. Are you satisfied with the recruiting that you're doing? In this economy, doing any recruiting is difficult.
I am very pleased, and so...
You're satisfied with the quality you're getting?
Yes, and there a couple of issues. One, there were things that the Congress did to help us in terms of raising our pay for officers, and allowing us to give retention bonuses to keep people. I talked to chiefs from all over the country, and to a person, everybody's having trouble recruiting and getting good people for a number of reasons to want to be involved in a law enforcement career. But I firmly believe that just like after 9/11, when the military and police and fire had no problem recruiting because people wanted to serve their country, I believe that January 6th helped us, because so many of the people that have come that have come on since then have said the reason that they were here is because they wanted to serve here because of January 6th.
Well, I appreciate that, and I hope you'll express the view of the chairman talked about this, the chairwoman talked about this, the appreciation that we have for all the Capitol Police. We don't really think about it, but police, fire, and military, unlike almost any other job in our society, when they sign on the dotted line, they're committing to put their life on the line for us, for other people. And that's an extraordinary commitment. And of course, on January 6th, we saw it in action. So please convey the deep appreciation that we have for the work. And I love to banter with your officers and see them, see how they're doing. And you have an extraordinary group. Congratulations and thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator King. Just following up on Senator King's questions and this threat issue, it would seem to me that kind of if we want to be practical about it, as he said, we're not going to have, most likely, not every member is going to have around-the-clock detail unless there is an actual threat. And so there's two ways of looking at it, depending on the resources. One is to change the level at which that's considered a threat, to perhaps scoop in more people sometimes for periods of time. And the second is for events that are publicly noticed or things that are a bit higher risk, that those are the ones that we're really focused on in terms of having that. And higher risk to me is more like people know you're going to be there, as opposed to some meeting that is not even publicized or something like that. So that is, I just think we have to be a little more practical about how we look at these things. And I have found our local police to be good when we call them ahead of time, but we don't even think about it ahead of time sometimes, about if things are out there or they are planned. But I think that's what we need to do. And I don't know if you want to expand on that a little more.
So you've hit the nail on the head, because oftentimes we don't know what's on your schedule or what's on any member's schedule unless they share it with us. And when they share it with us and say, hey, we've got a big event back home expecting, you know, 500 people or whatever, we can be proactive. The U.S. Capitol Police will reach out to the local jurisdiction there, let them know about the event, and see what they can do to assist at the event, even if it's just having an officer, you know, stand in the back of the room. Oftentimes, they're able to help us at events like that. The key is having the member's staff, reach out to us and let us know. We'll do the rest.
Mm-hmm. Okay. One of the things I mentioned earlier on that we're trying to work on is this bipartisan proposal, hopefully by the end of the year, to allow for the removal of members' personal information from public websites. We just did it for the federal judges. Could you talk about how that could be helpful when it comes to home addresses.
It would be a huge help. There's no question about that. You know, as you know, we will provide staff members and staff advice. Especially, we've just finished doing the new member orientation, and we talk to them about social media and about you know, what to put on social media, what not to put on social media. But you know, just to sort of help with that. But removing personally identifiable information of members really would impact not only the member, but it would impact their family. Just keeping you know, people's address and all this other personal identifiable information from being public would have a huge impact. And unfortunately, as we all know, the internet makes it very easy for people to find addresses and find information. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, that information is used to harm folks too often.
Right. And I think it's not, the question to ask is not could anyone ever find it out, because obviously some sophisticated people could figure out where you live. It is more for that moment, the person that might be just looking to harm in a particular day or moment. And I think many of us understand that, and that you're not probably limiting all your risk, but you're limiting some of your risk.
Anything helps.
Yeah. So you mentioned that the department is expanding its work beyond the Capitol in response to the threats, including opening field offices. I know Florida, California, I think one more, working with U.S. Attorney's Office across the country. Last year, the Capitol Police referred 458 threat cases for prosecution, 40 resulted, and I know part of this is to prioritize, 40 resulted in prosecution. Part of this is increasing the number of those cases that are prosecuted. And as a former prosecutor, I always believe that has a deterrent effect as well. So talk about your efforts there. I would like to allow for these prosecutors to be able to do things across state lines and the like. Talk about what's happening there.
So that we have been working with our appropriations folks to give us the funding to not only do the residential assessments and work with our law enforcement partners, but this third leg of the stool is the prosecutions, and I couldn't agree more than it has a deterrent effect. We do have special United States Assistant Attorneys, and they're specially assigned to work these threat cases. And we're working with DOJ to allow them, we're hopeful that we can get DOJ to say, it's not just they work them in that area, you know, in the San Francisco area or the area in Florida, that they can go across state lines and work them anywhere we need to work them. We just brought on board the third special USA to work here at the Capitol in D.C. So that will help us for cases here, but it would be nice to be able to send them anywhere we need to send them so that we can get more of those cases prosecuted. Look, the FBI and the U.S. Attorney's Office are very helpful, but they have a huge caseload, and for us, a threat against a member of Congress is our highest priority. It's not always their highest priority. So if we have our own folks to make sure these things get prosecuted, I think it's a big step in the right direction for us.
Mm-hmm. Good. Last question. I know you've made significant progress implementing each of the recommendations in this committee's joint report with Homeland Security to address the security planning and response failures that we saw on January 6th. What are your ongoing priorities for security at the Capitol in the coming years?
So the biggest issue is working with the architect of the Capitol to make those infrastructure changes and strengthen things. To include the camera system, which we're redoing. We've got more posts covered here than we've had certainly since January 6th. We've increased the number of our civil disturbance unit platoons. They are now fully equipped, fully trained. We have, as you know, better operational planning, and our partnership with our local agencies around the District, Maryland, and Virginia is really helped us numerous times. Whether it was the trucker convoy, the State of the Union, the abortion protests at the Supreme Court. We've had to call them in on a number of occasions, and again, our ability to reimburse them is gives us an advantage, but we've always had as many cops here as we need to get the job done.
All right, thank you. Senator Blunt?
Well, on that topic, Chief, as of many people as you need to get the job done, when you became chief, the balance didn't allow that as easily as it does now, and also began to disrupt any planned time off and other things. We thought morale was a significant problem. What kinds of things have you done, rather than evaluate morale, which is hard for us to do sitting here, what have you done that you believe has had the most impact on officers, their understanding they're appreciated, and the morale that comes with that?
Well, I think that the biggest impact we've had is the additional staffing. People can get days off. If they're scheduled to be off on a day, they can pretty much count on the fact that they'll be off instead of being told, no, you can't have that day off. There are fewer times when at the end of a shift, the sergeant will come and say, okay, Officer Blunt, you know, you thought you were going home. You got to stay here and do another shift because mm-hmm. we're short on the next shift. Mm-hmm. These things happened all the time. I had cops telling me that they'd gone a month without getting a day off. That's changed. And I'm not saying that there are still not times when we hold folks over or have to change days off, but it's far fewer than we were doing right after January 6th. So I think that made the biggest impact. I think the fact that we have, and I don't think that money ultimately is going to have a sustained impact on morale, but the fact that we've had, you know, a couple of years of retention bonuses, that we're now offering specialty pay to those who volunteer to do those specialty assignments like civil disturbance, I think that's made an impact where the folks feel like, okay, you know, people are acknowledging that this is extra work and that this does have a little bit more hazard as a part of it. So doing things like that that show the officers that we appreciate the sacrifices that they're making has made a difference as well. And I think that the fact that officers do feel appreciated, that doesn't happen by chance. I think that many of the things that that this committee has done, that you and Senator Klobuchar have done personally, and that Congress has done for the United States Capitol Police has sent a pretty strong message that people do care about what they do and do appreciate their sacrifices and do appreciate what they do every day. And if for any of us, if we feel like the people that we work for appreciate what we do, it makes a difference.
Well, I know you've worked hard on this, and I certainly know you're continuing, and we'd encourage that. You have a couple of vacancies on your executive team I'm wondering about. One is the Assistant Chief for Protective and Intelligence Operation, and the other is the Chief Administrative Officer. How are you doing in the effort to fill those two top jobs?
The announcement for the Chief Administrative Officer went out last week. My hope is that we can have that out for about a month or so, and my hope is that we get some good candidates to choose from, and we can make a selection for that in the next couple of months. The Assistant Chief for Protection and Intelligence, I've got an acting in there now, Jason Bell, who has a lot of experience in the protective responsibilities and investigations, so he's doing a good job. But my intent was to bring and is to bring someone in from the outside. I want to get that my reorganization plan, which I submitted to the Capitol Police Board. I want to get that approved, and that will allow me to start filling some of those senior level vacancies. Hopefully we can get to that soon as well. But in terms of the sworn positions, the executive, we're managing. I've got a good team. I have a lot of depth on my bench at the higher levels, at the inspector level, the captain level, really, really deep benches there. And so we've got folks that are in acting positions that are doing well. But eventually I've got a sort of a master reorganization plan that I'd like to get implemented, and all those senior level positions would be filled.
Chair?
Just one or two follow-ups. We talked about that some of the changes you've made and how you've reached a lot of the goals we set, recommendations. I'm still remembering the haunting words of one officer in the microphone when he allegedly said, "Does anyone have a plan?" on January 6th. The department has made clear progress with respect to operational planning, particularly by requiring a department-wide incident assessment plan for all large high-profile events. Can you expand briefly on what has been done to improve preparedness for large events?
So we have, when we do these, plan for these events, first of all, we brought on an executive from the United States Secret Service who is an expert in planning, and he has really coached us and helped us change to exactly where I think we need to be. It's now routine for us to do tabletop exercises both internally and with external partners to moving to, you know, when we get just a few days ahead of a big event. We're involving outside agencies in a way that we never did before. We are training with other agencies. These folks that we're asking to come in to help us, we're training with those agencies. We are also we have a good, close relationship with the National Guard. And I will tell you that if I would only call the National Guard in the most dire circumstances, but we have, I just met with General McCandless last week, just to sort of, you know, stay on the same page with things. We have practiced the drill of how I would go about.
And as you know, Senator Blunt and I changed the law, so it was easier to make
yes,
the call.
Yes, so, but we've practiced how we can get that done very efficiently. Mm-hmm. And we're doing weekly intelligence calls with our regional partners. So all these things that we're doing now that weren't being done before January 6th have I think, got us on the right page to make sure that there's going to be no failures in terms of our operational planning for an event.
Okay. There is more to do on how the department handles intelligence, as we've talked about. Can you tell us how the department has improved the sharing of information with officers on the front lines and feedback from officers on those improvements?
So I think you all know that we issued cell phones to all the officers. But we put out daily bulletins as well that come to their cell phones, you know, daily intelligence bulletins. When we are having a big event, Assistant Chief Sean Gallagher will go to every roll call to do an in-person briefing for officers to know what to expect, you know, for the big event coming up. The fact that we do after-action reports on every single big event, we get feedback directly from the officers, from officials, officers, everybody involved in the event is able to provide their feedback in terms of in an after-action report. And with our incident action plans, that those plans that we have that are typically 20, 30 pages long that have every detail about the planning for the incident, those are widely circulated. So everybody knows what everybody else's responsibilities are. Everybody knows what everybody else is doing. So again, it helps for everybody to sort of have a bigger picture of all these events as we go into them.
Mm-hmm. One of the things I raised was equipment, and I know you've ordered equipment, and when you appeared before us in January, we spoke about how, while all the new equipment had been ordered, some of the supply chain issues had delayed delivery. Are you now fully equipped with the type of equipment that you believe you need?
So we have over 1,000 officers that have all the equipment that they need. In fact, I don't think there's anybody, any uniformed officer in USB that does not have their equipment. There's still supply chain issues are still there, but now there's the few officers that don't have all of their new equipment it's a very small number, but the people that need them the most have them, and I'm sure within a few months we'll have everybody 100%, but again, over 1,000 of the USB officers are fully equipped.
The department, as you noted, has taken steps to formalize a civil disturbance unit to ensure that its officers are properly trained. How have these changes improved the effectiveness? What additional, could you just talk a little bit about the on-site training and drills and what's going on?
So we have all of the, everybody in CDU, by the way, that we asked for volunteers, and we've got six or seven platoons ready. I have that written down somewhere. I'll find it. But we've got more platoons of CDU officers that are trained and equipped. They train with other agencies. We train here as well. The officials, the people who are overseeing the CDU, have all been trained as well. We brought outside trainers in from a couple of European countries that have much more experience in dealing with unruly crowds than we do, and they provided us really amazing training that we took advantage of. So and we have established specialty pay for the mm-hmm. civil disturbance units, so that one of the big problems that we used to have was that when we would say we need, 100 people to come in, 100 CDU officers to come in for an event, not everybody would show up. There'd be a lot of folks calling sick and that sort of thing. Now we've got folks that want to be there, want to do this. They're training with the people that they're going to work with. So all of that stuff is making for better outcomes when we use them.
All right. Well, thank you. And I think we're finished up here, but I want to thank Ranking Member Blunt for this productive final hearing and for all the work that he's done, not just on these public safety issues, but leading the Rules Committee, and particularly on the Electoral Count Act. He's going to end the year with strength, as has been noted, in getting that important bill through the two of us to update that old legislation. I'm also grateful, Chief, for your leadership and the progress that you've made and the openness that you have to take our ideas and listen to members and work things out, and your devotion to working on this member safety issue as well.
Senator, thank you very much. And I did want to say to Senator Blunt that you may not remember, but in my first few days in this job, you came over to my office. And I will tell you that I was pretty nervous about the fact that, that you were coming over to talk to me. And you brought over the Senate rules book and had my name embossed on it, and I thought that was very kind of you to do that. And I'm a big believer in Maya Angelou, who said, you won't remember what people said, you won't remember what people did, but you'll remember how people made you feel. And for someone who was as nervous about coming into this job, when you left, I felt like that I had much more confidence that whatever it was going to take to get the Capitol Police where they needed to be, that was going to be able to happen because of the talk that you and I had and the fact that I knew somebody in your position with your stature had in their heart the support for the Capitol Police that we needed to get things done. So I want to thank you for giving me the confidence to do this job when I just had a few days here, and I appreciate your support throughout my tenure here. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Chief.
What a great way to end this hearing, because I think it's just an illustration of the kind of work that Senator Blunt does every day, so much of it behind the scenes. And Chief, when you were talking about going through calling if there was a crisis with the commander of the National Guard, I was thinking of whatever next crisis I have starting, January 7th, and I will probably still call Roy Blunt to get his advice. And so we thank Roy for his service. We're going to keep the record open for 1 week, and we thank you, Roy.
Thank you. Thank you, Chief. Thank you, Chairman.
The hearing's adjourned.